So we're here to announce that I've been nominated for Prime Minister.
Oh, yes. I would vote.
First order I bring to the Parliament is to disband the Parliament. I don't know. Like, would that even make a difference anymore? Disbanding the Parliament.
If you can just limit the number of dicks they suck, that would be a real help.
I'll send that over to the Russian press office.
You don't
for
want that 37 times?
Yeah. Wow, this is a little bit more than what I thought it was going
to
be.
This is way more than I expected it to be. That's why I was like, are we in the right place?
I know, I was like, this is my intervention. I know it is. Is that my mother over there?
Brian, I love you to death. But your obsession with drink has gotten too far.
Well, tell you what, kicking off with an obvious question. Talking about love, why do you think there is still... talking about love.
That's a good segue.
Why is there so much love for this very little but very beautiful piece of cinema you guys made?
I said this earlier in the Q&A that we did. The great thing about the first film, Clerks, was that Kevin was able to capture what he was living, working a retail job in a local community, convenience store. And... and it's now becoming a trend, especially the last 20 years, being overeducated and unemployed and not having the proper kind of jobs that fill the education you want to get is a draining thing. And it's society is doing it a lot these days. There's a lot of people who have great education and loads of education and debt, student loan debt, that the jobs aren't there. And so he took it in a very microcosm way. It's just a convenience store clerk wanting to do a better thing, station in life, having his friend who's happy with his station in life at that time, and just poking a finger in the eye of things and observations that he has. So you've either worked at a very crappy retail job, or you've been in a store where the attendants there were really crappy at their job. So it relates to you either as a customer or as an employee. And the success that Kevin has had with his succeeding films afterwards has kept his work in the limelight for so long, and the fact that we've had careers for 25 years in this industry is testament to how writing what you know and writing what you love and sticking to you, be you. Don't try to be what you think people want of you, mm-hmm. but just write for you, make for you, make the film you want to tell, not what you think the people want to see. You'll find your audience, and your audience will support you, going like, yeah, man, I'm Silent Bob, or yeah, man, I'm that weak-willed Dante Hicks, or hey, man, I'm that foul-mouthed, Randall spitting water at life kind of guy. So there's characters for everybody in the film that I think people can relate to.
What's your advice to anyone in the business who wants to be in the business and come through?
Train and know the reasons why they want it, because I've come across very many people who they just want to be rich and famous, and that's so not the reason to be in this business.
Because
I mean, it's not going to happen that quickly, and you may or may not get rich and famous, and it's the passion that's going to keep driving to do it over and over. I mean, and I've had, especially the last year for me, has been very difficult just living. And I've had to kind of reassess. It's like, do I go out and find a 9-to-5 job? But if I do that, I cannot give it up. I can't. And it's like, I really was in that position where it's like, I can't do that. So it's like the passion just keeps on driving it.
I agree. It's all passion. And I believe that in the arts, it kind of chooses you. You don't choose it, because somebody told me a piece of a nugget years ago about, if you think you can be happy doing anything else, go do it. But if you believe this is really for you, then strap in and realize it's going to be, a lot of hard knocks, but you have to have the passion for it. It's that simple. I had a high school drama teacher that told me, don't even think of it after my first audition. He's like, you know, and I was stage manager, but I had such passion and such desire, and probably at that point, just a lot more nerve to just keep going. And luckily I found some great training and I hit an age where it began to work out a little better and I was doing better at it. But I don't think that you can, it's like anything that somebody is naturally born to do or want to do, you know, it's in you. It's hard to walk away from it. Like she's saying, you don't want to.
Especially on the acting end, you should be able to hear the word no 85% of the time. And the no isn't because you suck. The no isn't because you can't do what they're asking you to do. The no, a lot of time, especially in television and film, is you're not the right physical type we're looking for. You're not the right ethnotype we're looking for. You're not the right, oh, we have so-and-so cast already, and I just don't see the two of you being a chemistry kind of thing. You know, I get the question all the time, like, how is it working with Rosario Dawson? Because films wouldn't pair us two together normally in Hollywood, but we did it, the Kevin thought to do it in this, and as much as the character is a hideous shot, as he likes to say, it worked, the chemistry, you kind of see why the chemistry worked with those two characters. And then as an actor going through the training, I started in theater. I did theater for quite a few years before even auditioning for my first film, which was Clerks, the original Clerks. It is having that passion, but also being considerate to everybody who's involved in the project. There is no one who I don't ask, hey, what's your name? And there's no one who I go like, I want my coffee. Where's that boy, my coffee? Oh, there's too much sugar in this. You know, I've never been that way in my life, ever. And people are like, wow, you're so cool and so nice. I want to thank you for being there. I'm like, don't thank me. Thank my parents. I was brought up in an Irish Catholic household. My parents and my two older brothers, all born in Ireland, in Galway, the West Coast. They emigrated to New York City in 65, and then I was born in 69. And then we holidayed back in Galway, and then I'd visit family up in Birmingham or in London. After this weekend, I'm going down to Hythe to visit my aunt. My mother's already down there because she flew in with me, and we're going to have family get-togethers. But it's that kind of upbringing that kept me on the straight and narrow, and having friends keeping me
grounded.
And I'm still a huge Uber nerd, so I did table gaming and role-playing gaming, and it was the role-play gaming that kept me sane and off the streets of getting into trouble. And my father passed away when I was 15 years old, so that was the kind of thing that got me grounded. I left the real world to get into fantasy world and doing D&D and all these other gamings, which that's why nerd culture and these cons, I completely am right in that same vein, and I'm proud of it too. You know, mutant and proud, well, I'm nerd and proud. So it's the same thing. And I don't deny it. And I don't deny it. This has always been, I was just talking to someone about this. So I'll say, cons are a safe space. There's no one who comes in here and we judge them. Yeah, we have cosplay costumes, but they knew they were getting into a contest, so we're judging it. But there's no judging. You could be whatever character you want to be. You can think about, you can have fandom about anything. You can hear the occasional Star Wars, Star Trek argument about which is better, or Game of Thrones, Lord of the Rings, or whatever you have it. But we're all that community of nerds, which that's what I love about it. All the politics that happen outside, all the world events, all the horrors that are happening, natural and man-made, end when you walk through these convention doors. And people go like, aren't you sick of doing conventions and hearing people go, hey, you're supposed to be here today? No, I love it.
Yeah.
Because we're all here for the same reason, with the love of art. We're all part of artists.
Yeah.
Comic books are arts. Like in America, I always talk about funding the schools, funding the arts. We're all cutting these programs to fund sports. Sports, great, great, great thing to have kids do, get outdoors, be involved. But artists, we all got dressed today. You may not all be artists at all, but when you got dressed today and you went to your closet, you took out your drawer and you saw your shirts, you picked this color because it went with this pants to go with that shoot. That's an artistic choice. That was taught to you, color, shapes, and coordination. So I get passionate about it because I don't want to see the arts die. So
their particular organic memories, things from set, stories that fans perhaps don't know that make you smile the most or you think are the most poignant?
It's a lot of it is actually starting to kind of get fuzzy a little bit. And I'm one of those triggered memory type of people. So it's like all of a sudden we'll just kind of be talking about something and then it's like, oh yeah, I remember that. But it's always a fond memory. And one thing too that people ask me is like, what was it like working on there? And the best way that I could put it is like, it's, you know, when it's your first experience working on a movie set, you won't have that feeling, that experience again. But I did say, it's like, well, maybe, you know, if I was working on a major motion picture, it might be close to it, but not exactly. It's like he said, I come from theater as well. We did theater together before we were in Clerks. And so that also, it's a whole different type of feeling and experience. But just, oops, sorry. I think, and the way that I put it is like, we were all in the same boat together experiencing something for the first time and, you know, translating from the stage to film. Those are my experiences, my moments, my memories.
Well, other than almost getting arrested before my audition, that story's on the IMDb.
That's true.
That's a pretty crazy memory that I didn't really get to share with anybody because I didn't want anybody to know back then because I didn't want to cast a negative dispersion on myself. But I got to the audition very early. It was at a short town, the Atlantic Highlands Theater there, and I went out on a jetty on the beach and it was closed and I was getting ready for the audition and gesturing wildly and doing my thing. And from the shore, it must have looked like there was a lunatic out on the jetty. They thought I was inebriated or whatnot, or maybe suicidal. And I said, well, listen, if you're going to arrest me, can you do it after the audition, please? And they're like, well, this, you know, obviously there's nothing wrong with this guy. He's just a little, maybe a little too passionate about what he's doing. But this is
93 before Bluetooth earpiece.
Yeah.
Where you see someone talking.
Right. Now he's probably on a phone or whatever. But that's a pretty wild memory for me. And it's a good one, too, because I'm also sober from some pretty brutal alcoholism days. And back then I was suffering with it pretty badly. So to look back at that now and to the there's a lot of levity in that story for me now.
The memories of just the first of experience of shooting a film with a bunch of people. We all had regular daytime jobs. We'd do our 9-to-5 job. I'd go home from where my daytime job was. I'd sleep, try to get some sleep from like 5 o'clock in the afternoon till 9:30 at night. Get up, shower, shit, shave, get out there and grab something to eat, get down an hour south from where I live to get to the store, get ready in makeup. And we'd close the store at like around 10:30 at night, 11 o'clock, and then shoot from like 11 o'clock at night till about 5:30, 6 a.m. doing scenes and then take out all the equipment, which wasn't much, but take most of the equipment out of the convenience store, over, bring it over to the video store because the video store wouldn't open until like 11 o'clock. And then start it all over again. Go back. I'd work 9-to-5 at that job and go home and do it. And we did that for 22, 23 days or so. And those memories and that grind, and then being accepted to the New York feature film market, which is a film festival that doesn't even exist anymore, for the first screening, and having 24 people in the audience, 12 of which was like us. But luckily, on a Sunday, the last Sunday of the festival at 11 a.m., it was, you know, we were like, it was like the death slot for films. But thankfully, we had a great angel in our audience by the name of Mr. Bob Hawk, who saw the film and was a person who influenced a lot of filmmakers and recommended it to the Sundance Film Festival. And then that's where the spark started to grow. And to think that I thought I'd just have a VHS copy of the film for friends to goof around about and like, well, look at this goofy thing that we did. And for your audiences that don't know what VHS is, ask your grandparents what VHS is. To now see that here we are going on a 25th anniversary kind of feel about it. And the subsequent films that followed and being a part of those films and seeing where these characters went, like the Dante and Randall character in Clerks 2, and we did the cartoon series, which was one of the fun childhood dreams of my life, was to be a part of a cartoon, is undeniably an incredible blessing that I'll always be grateful for. And to see that people like yourselves, this room is full of people who are artists themselves, who are writers themselves, who take themselves seriously at what they do and enjoy what we do is a great blessing. And we're humbled and honored that mm-hmm. people still want to see these things. And we're happily anticipating the reaction of the fan base, because now we are at the age where people of our age who had kids, now their kids are old enough to see this movie properly without embarrassment and see the other Kevin Smith films without embarrassment and love it and enjoy it. There's many cons where families will come where a father will bring a son, like, my son loves that whole donkey scene and stuff like that, where it's like, it's kind of awkward, you know? Or an African-American fan coming up going like, that porch monkey scene, I'm like, is awesome. Like, good to hear, thanks. It's kind of cool. And, you know, the everyday man kind of feel that Kevin has with his writing makes the audience feel comfortable with us immediately. There's no like, oh my God, it's Sir Richard Attenborough, oh, and you want to be proper with them, or Anthony Hopkins, which is like, hey, what's up, Dante? You know, they're already comfortable to scream at us across a room, which is kind of nice that we have that comfortable feel with it. Plus, I have a comfortable way of just poking fun and taking the piss out of them as well. So it's that kind of give and take that I've always enjoyed with an audience, that we've always enjoyed with an audience, mm-hmm. that makes this fan base and makes that, once again, why is it relative and still relevant to now, is that kind of feel.
It's pretty amazing dynamic, because no matter how crude some of the humor gets, there's so much heart mm-hmm. that you can't help but embrace it and love it. I mean, my mom, God bless her, I miss her, she would be in tears over Jay and Bob, no matter how filthy Jay got. And I couldn't get over that she wasn't like blown out by the language and some of the real, you know, some of it's quite crude, especially the first film is pretty filthy, but there's so much heart that comes through somehow. Amazing. Amazing dynamic.
Just recently said this in an interview that, you know, after seeing Endgame and seeing the culmination of these 22 films coming together, I'm seeing, without some, you know, Iron Man kind of event, no, I'm not spoiling it, the culmination of all of Kevin's View Askew films coming together with this Jay and Bob. I'm not saying this is our last View Askew film, and by any means, but it had that kind of feel in reading it and then seeing the amount of people that got on board to be a part of it. Now, Kevin's been posting on his Instagram and his Facebook and his Twitter accounts different shots from the set with different people from cameos of the previous films and new cameos, for that matter. And people and fans, and I'd read comments like, why are you telling us all this? You're spoiling it, and blah, blah, blah. It's not even a third of who's in this film. I would sit there on set and scenes and be like, I can't believe blah, 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 and blah, blah, blah are on this set right now. That's a highly insult to Mr. Blah, blah, blah. Do you know what I'm saying? I'm sorry, blah, blah, blah. No, but, I mean, it's that kind of thing where it's like, God, this is going to be... I can't wait for the fall to come around. I think he's going to be, I believe he's working on a trailer to hopefully be seen at San Diego. So hopefully San Diego will be a trailer release and then hopefully a fall release. Now, that's nothing new in the press. He said that it's probably a fall release. So I know he's working on it now. I know he's been reaching out to different bands to do the soundtrack. So he's in that stage of the thing. Look, we're not a heavy special effects film, so it's not like, well, we got 2 years of 15 houses putting special effects on Jay's bong smoke. So once the film is edited, Kevin edits while we film.
Yeah.
So literally the 3 days prior, he's on his laptop and and the technology's gotten so small too to edit. But he's doing it and he's in the process of working on other projects, and hopefully with the success of the Jay and Bob movie, that'll spur the other movies that we're thinking about bringing out for the viewers.
You
know,
how do you say War Rats 2 on anything?
I don't know what you're talking about. Last question. Thank you so much.